are back here, and now, as you notice, I have Professor Bhandarkar on my right hand side and Professor Puranik on my left hand side. So we are ready to take questions. First, I am going to 1257 HCTM. 1257 HCTM, Kaithal, Haryana. Over to you.
There is one question number RAC. All the pH, all the psychrometric chart are drawn on a corresponding to the atmospheric pressure. And to find the WBT, what method should be adopted? Similarly, in the case of PS1, how to find the WBT? There is one standard equation known as the carrier equation. In that, we need saturation temperature corresponding to saturation pressure. But to find the value of WBT in all the cases when pressure is not atmospheric. Over to you, sir.
I think in the carrier equation, you notice that there is a PT term, which is the total pressure. So if you just substitute the total pressure there, that would be good enough, and you will get, you just notice that the temperature has to be given in degrees Celsius, whereas all the pressure units have to be in consistent units. So if you give bar, then all the pressure should be in bar, and you will get your answer also in bar. Thank you.
How to find PV dash? How to find PV dash? In the carrier equation, there is one term known as PV dash, which is corresponding to the saturation pressure corresponding to the WBT. So how to find this PV dash?
Okay, so the question you are asking, yes, is that how to find PV dash? PV dash is nothing but the saturation pressure at the WBT. So if you are given the PV, you are actually supposed to guess a value of WBT, and the P saturation corresponding to that WBT will be available from the steam tables. So as I said earlier, if you use that equation, you have to do trial and error. But PV dash is directly the saturation pressure corresponding to the WBT, and that has nothing to do with the total pressure. You just have to look up your steam tables for it. Thank you.
Still, I have a doubt how to find WBT. Neither WBT is known, we know the total pressure, we know the DBT. How to find the WBT?
See, even at one atmosphere.
Repeat the question.
Okay, the question is that how will you find the WBT if the total pressure and the DBT is known? The answer is, if only the total pressure and DBT are known, no one, you cannot find a WBT, because there are many WBTs possible which depend on PV, the saturation, the vapor pressure of water vapor in the atmosphere. So either you have to know PV, or you have to be given specific humidity with which you will find PV, or you have to be given relative humidity with again with which you will find PV. So in some or the other form, you have to find PV, either by using dew point temperature or relative humidity or specific humidity, or PV should be given itself. Without that, you can't find the WBT, because there is no unique WBT if a given total pressure and DBT are known. The third quantity regarding how much water vapor is there in the atmosphere has to be known. Thank you.
It means WH to be known to find the WBT. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Over and above.
Thank you.
1113 SB Patil College, Indapur. Over to you.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Hello. Good evening, sir. Sir, my question is, for the same capacity of the plant, whether we can select external combustion engine or internal combustion engine? For the same capacity or for the same power output?
Yes, the your question is, how do you select an external combustion engine or an internal combustion engine? First thing is, this is a major policy decision, and the advantage of an external combustion engine is that the combustion takes place in a separate furnace or a separate combustion chamber. The working fluid does not get into contact with the combustion process at all. So if you have what are known as unclean fuels, which produce lots of pollutants and lots of residues, then naturally you would prefer external combustion, because the working fluid in the cycle just doesn't come to know what has changed in the outside world. So I would prefer, as far as possible, for such fuels, external combustion, because internal combustion means you have to see to it that the not only air, but the fuel and the air fuel mixture and the combustion products are compatible with the materials which are used, or the material used has to be compatible with this. So that is what I think I hinted in the morning, that if you have internal combustion engine, then engineering is that much more difficult, because the materials have to be selected properly, and the life of an internal combustion engine is usually lower than that of an external combustion engine, mainly because the internal combustion engine various components come in direct contact with the gases undergoing combustion and also the exhaust products, which are quite often corrosive in nature. Over to you.
Sir, one more question. Is there any loss of efficiency in case of external combustion engine as compared to IC engine?
The question is whether there is a loss in efficiency. Loss in efficiency, see, the external combustion cycles and the internal combustion cycles are different. But if you say that suppose I have a Brayton cycle and I implement it using air and internal combustion with a given fuel, and implement another cycle with air but the heat exchange through a heat exchanger, so convert it into an external thing. Yes, the efficiency for a given air temperature, that is combustion temperature, will be higher for the internal combustion cycle, lower for the external combustion cycle, because the external combustion cycle will have to run at a lower temperature because of the delta T required for heat transfer. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Over and out, sir.
Thank you. 1205 Mahatma Gandhi Missions College, Noida, Uttar Pradesh. Over to you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I have three very small questions. In case of heat engines, you define the second law efficiency of the engine. Likewise, can we not define the second law COP of the refrigerator?
Your question was about the second law efficiency. I think in the definition of our efficiencies of engines, we have not defined anything called the second law efficiency. We have just defined efficiency as a ratio of W dot net divided by Q dot supplied. So I don't think that is either based on first law or second law, because it's just a ratio. It's not a first law efficiency or second law efficiency. Over to you.
Because in some books, you know, we are using that term. In many books, we are using that term, second law efficiency of the engine. Likewise, there is a second law COP of the refrigerator. The COP of the refrigerator ratio, they are also defining like refrigerating efficiency.
Okay, but in proper thermodynamics, these when it comes to engines and refrigerators, the terms first law efficiency and second law efficiency are not standard definitions. So when some books uses it, I will have to be very careful. I will have to see what the definitions they have provided are, and if there are any exercises, I will have to solve those exercises using the definitions provided in that book. Over to you.
The auto cycle and diesel cycle that you have discussed, are they air standard auto cycle or diesel cycle?
Yes, the auto cycle, the diesel cycle and the Brayton cycle, which I have described, are what I have described is the standard representation and the standard analysis of these cycles. The word air standard is an old thing. We don't have to really use the word air, because the analysis assumes the working fluid not really an air, but any gas which is assumed as ideal gas with constant specific heats will do. So, I do not really need to use the old terminology air standard cycle or air standard analysis. I think a standard analysis is good enough, because the same analysis is applicable in case of Brayton cycle if it works with say helium. So, we would not then call it helium standard efficiency. We will say it is a standard efficiency if helium is the working fluid. Over to you.
Okay, the next question is, you use the word potential when you derive that expression for availability of closed system. So, this potential is which potential? Whether you would like to call as a work potential or thermodynamic potential or thermal potential?
No, I have not defined any potential there. All I have said is that the availability, notice that if there is no heat transfer to any system other than the ambient, then the maximum work that can be obtained is the decrease in that availability. That is what we have shown. So, at that stage I simply said that the availability can be considered at some potential, the decrease in which gives you the maximum amount of work which is possible. Since what is extractable is work, you can say it is work potential. But I have not defined it as a potential. I have said it can be considered as something similar to a potential, because the idea in physics of a potential is a decrease in potential is the interaction, typically work interaction. Over to you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Over to you.
Thank you. Over and out. 1054 National College of Engineering, Tirunelveli. Over to you.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, I have a doubt in cycles, sir. Is there any difference in standard analysis for diesel cycle and Brayton cycles? Because there are two cycles are under in the same classification of cycles, sir.
No, the question is about comparison of diesel cycle and Brayton cycle. At cycles themselves, they are different. So, although the procedure for standard analysis is similar, the results will be different, because the diesel cycle has one constant pressure process and one constant volume process apart from two isentropic processes, whereas Brayton cycle has both processes constant pressure apart from two processes which are isentropic. Over to you.
Hello, Professor.
Yes.
That yesterday's test, the isentropic process may not be reversible, one answer we have received. And what are all the restricted case this is possible, sir?
There seems to be some confusion. An isentropic process only means DS is 0, and I think I have isentropic, adiabatic and reversible. In my, at the end of my second law, I have spent some time on comparing this, and I wrote the following expression. DS is dq by t plus dsp. First thing is, ds is a change in property. So, the left hand side of this equation is an exact differential. dq by t is a process dependent thing, inexact differential in general, because dq is an inexact differential. And since dq is in general inexact differential, ds will also be an inexact differential, because you can't have two exact differentials being equated to an inexact differential. Now, the second law says that DSP has to be greater than 0, or at best it can be equal to 0. DQ, we know a system can absorb heat, system can reject heat. So, dQ by T can be greater than 0. For an adiabatic process, it can be 0. For some other process, it can be less than 0. And DS is a change in property. So it can be equal to 0, it can be greater than 0, it can be less than 0. We have steam tables, you select two states depending on what is initial and what is final, you can have any DS, any sign for DS. Now notice that isentropic only means that DS is 0. Isentropic does not mean that DQ is 0 or DSP is 0. For example, you can have DSP positive and DQ negative, making the right hand side equal to 0 and balancing this equation. So this goes to show that isentropic means, isentropic does not automatically mean that the process is adiabatic. It also shows that isentropic process does not automatically mean that the process is reversible. I think that should explain your query. Over to you.
Sir, one more question.
Yes.
That auto cycle and diesel cycle, a basic doubt. After end of the reaching the point number 4, last process is expansion process. When the exhaust valve gets open, 4 directly goes to 5, then it is coming to 6. Why
right.
4 directly goes to 6, sir?
See, okay, this is an idealized analysis. So that is why we tend to split the cycle into ideal sub-processes. That is why during induction we did not take care, or we assume no pressure drop as the air comes in, okay, for example. Similarly, we have assumed the compression and expansion processes in Otto cycle and part of the second expansion process in the diesel cycle to be isentropic. When it comes to 4, the pressure is higher than ambient, and if at that stage, two things will happen. First thing is exhaust valve will open. In actual practice, it will not open suddenly, it will open slowly, start opening even before it, the piston reaches TDC. But in the ideal cycle, we assume that it opens suddenly so that our expansion process can be smoothly extended up to the bottom dead center, 0.4, and then when it is open suddenly, all that happens is if the internal pressure is higher than ambient, sufficient air will rush out of the exhaust port to drop the pressure to 1. So that is the almost constant volume 4 to 1 pressure reduction process. And then of course the piston moves from BDC to TDC, and the idealization of this exhaust process where the fluid is pushed out is that we assume it to be at constant pressure, neglecting any rise in pressure because of the flow resistance in the exhaust valve, the exhaust pipe, silencer, converter and all that. Over to you.
Thank you, Professor. Over you, Ian.
Over and out. Thank you. 1089, KLE College of Engineering and Technology, Chikodi. Over to you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
It is question related to the idealization of the cycle, sir.
Yes.
How this, can you repeat this idealization concept, sir?
See, when the cycle is based on a gas as a working fluid, it is possible for us to idealize things and obtain or try to obtain algebraic relationships between interactions and then simple formula or not so complicated formula for efficiency and some other parameters. This idealization requires two things. We have to idealize the working fluid, which we do by assuming it to be an ideal gas with constant specific heats, so that the equation of state is simply PV equals RT, and delta U can be written down as CV delta T, delta H can be written down as CP delta T. The second idealization which we have to do is about the processes. In real life, no process will be isentropic, no process will really be adiabatic, and nothing will be reversible. Similarly, because the piston is continuously moving, we will have hardly any constant volume process and hardly any constant pressure process. So the idealization requires that we neglect pressure drop through ducts. That is one of the idealizations we do. Second thing is compression and expansion processes, which are adiabatic, are assumed to be, which are approximately adiabatic, are assumed to be not only adiabatic but also reversible and hence isentropic. The third one are the processes in which heat transfer takes place. These are the combustion processes and the part of the exhaust process in IC engines. In the combustion process, depending on how fast the combustion takes place, for example, it takes place pretty quickly in Otto cycle, petrol engine. So we tend to model it, or we do model it as a constant volume combustion. It is only a model and an approximation to provide us simple results algebraically. Similarly, to begin with, we model the combustion process in diesel cycle as a constant pressure process, knowing fully well that in real life it is nowhere near constant process. Okay. So the next level of approximation for a diesel cycle is a dual cycle, for which you can do the analysis, you will get a more complicated formula. Over to you.
So my next question is to Puranik sir.
Go ahead, he's here.
Sir, you have told regarding the purely convergent nozzle. It has been told that when the PB by P0 is equal to 1, there will be no flow. And PE by P0 is equal to 1, so the back pressure reduces such that PB by P0 will increase or will be more than the critical pressure ratio. My question is, so when the back pressure reduces, the area will increase. As the area increases, the velocity flow will decrease. As the velocity flow will decrease, the Mach number has to be less than 1. But in the second case, the PB reduces to critical pressure, and it has been shown that the Mach pressure is exactly equal to 1. Sir, why it is like that?
Your question is on the operation of the purely convergent nozzle. So there seems to be some confusion as far as what you understand by the back pressure and the role of the back pressure is. So let me first clarify that we have a nozzle that is fixed in shape. So at any particular axial location, the area of cross section is fixed. The largest area of cross section is at the inlet, and it monotonically decreases to become the smallest area at the exit, and that is why we call this purely convergent nozzle. Now the back pressure is actually the pressure of the reservoir into which this nozzle is discharging. Okay, so the back pressure is actually external to the nozzle, absolutely. So what ends up happening is that if the back pressure is equal to your upstream stagnation pressure, there is absolutely no driving potential for the flow, and therefore the flow is zero. However, as you start reducing the back pressure, then slowly there is a delta P available for the flow to establish and to take place through the nozzle. And as you increase the delta P by continuously decreasing the back pressure, the flow, the mass flow rate and the velocity and the Mach number, etc., will all keep on increasing. This will happen until the back pressure is so low that the exit plane pressure is going to be equal to the critical pressure corresponding to whatever stagnation pressure you have, at which point the Mach number in the exit plane becomes equal to 1. So what you need to remember is that the back pressure is external to the nozzle, and in the operation characteristics as we describe those, it is assumed that we have some control over this back pressure, and we are in a position to change this back pressure according to our will. Hopefully once you understand that, your query would be clarified. Thank you.
So I have one more question for you. Sir, in your slide page number 38, it is told that if m is equal to 1, dv by v is finite only if dA by A is equal to 0. But actually the area velocity relation is dv by v is equal to the ratio of dA by A to the m square minus 1. So if m is 1 and dA by dA is 0, dv by dv will be infinite. Why it is given that if m is equal to 1, dv by v is finite only if dA by A is 0, equal to 0?
Yeah, so your question is related to the interpretation of the area velocity relation when it comes to Mach number of 1. So as you quoted, the area velocity relation is dv over v is equal to dA over A divided by m squared minus 1. What I wanted to convey here is that if m is equal to 1 is a situation that is going to occur in your nozzle, then because m is equal to 1, that denominator m squared minus 1 will become 0. However, physically speaking, something divided by 0, which would imply that things are going to be infinite, is not going to be acceptable because the left-hand side relates to the velocity, which is a physical quantity. So just because m is equal to 1 is going to be reached somewhere, there is no reason to believe on any basic physical principle that the velocity can really shoot to infinity. So this paradox is resolved essentially by saying that if m is equal to 1 is going to be reached, in order for dv over v, which is a physical quantity, to be finite, we must come up to the conclusion that dA over A also has to be equal to 0. The reason is because then the right hand side will become 0 over 0 sort of a situation, which typically has a finite limit from calculus. So it's a combination of a calculus concept and a physical interpretation associated with not having a physical quantity like velocity suddenly for no reason going to infinity. Hopefully these two concepts combined together is going to explain your answer. Thank you. Your question, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Sir, in case of subcooled water region, we are approximating that is an incompressible fluid. Is there a concept behind that subcooled, in case of subcooled water, sir?
Yeah, I think the question is addressed to me. The question is, question pertains to properties of subcooled water, and what I have presented is only an approximation to be used in case two things happen. Number one, you do not have the data in your steam tables, which would be the case if you are using the Mathur Mehta steam tables and you are at reasonably low pressures. And number two, the pressure range that you are talking about is not very high, and I mentioned as an example that this is a reasonably okay approximation up to a pressure of roughly 50 bar, nothing special about it. Now up to 50 bar, the water, subcooled water or compressed liquid water, can be shown to be reasonably incompressible. Not exactly, because pressure does affect the density. You can assume it to be reasonably incompressible, and if it is reasonably incompressible for such a fluid, you can show, such a liquid you can show, because fluid is almost always considered compressible, whereas liquid you may consider incompressible. The three main thermodynamic properties, volume, internal energy and entropy, will depend only on one parameter, and that would be temperature. Or if you take the quartet, temperature, volume, internal energy and entropy, select one and all other things would become fixed. Volume goes out of contention because volume is invariant. So that means there is a direct one-to-one relationship between temperature and internal energy and entropy. So if you want to determine the properties of the subcooled liquid, go to a stage where the pressure is different but the temperature is same, and one such state which is usually tabulated is the saturated liquid state. I have provided links to a more detailed steam table, the NIST steam table. It is available for free download. I recommend you download it. You need not print it, but in the subcooled liquid zone, you will notice how good this approximation is, because they have tabulated compressed water and superheated steam. Unfortunately, they have not tabulated the internal energy. You will have to calculate the internal energy from the values of enthalpy and specific volume and pressure. But you can look at the entropy values and notice that they are reasonably independent of pressure. Remember, it is an approximation, so do not expect this to be true in an exact sense. Over to you.
Please repeat the concept of dead state, what we explained in availability concept.
There is nothing special about the concept of dead state. The dead state is defined only as, of course it was yesterday, when a system is brought by some means to a pressure and temperature which is the ambient pressure and ambient temperature, that is supposed to be a dead state of the system. Because if a system is at the ambient pressure and ambient temperature, unless you do some interaction with the system like pressurizing it or heating it, it is provide some sort of an interaction, it will not move away from that state. That is why it is called a dead state. So the dead state of a system means look at the ambient pressure, ambient temperature, and bring the system down to that pressure and that temperature, and that is the dead state of the system. Over to you.
Sir, please repeat the that super saturation, sir, yesterday.
Okay, I'll not repeat it because I don't think it's proper to discuss that in detail in the thermodynamics course. I recommend you look up the books by Moore and Sewerding. You will get enough information there on supersaturation, particularly that in a nozzle. And yesterday's raw videos, I am told, have already been uploaded. The slides are also up there. So if you want to go back to that portion where I mentioned something about supersaturation, you can refer to that. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Over and all.
Thank you. 1071 Amruta Vishwavidyapeetam, Coimbatore. Over to you.
Sir, good evening, sir. So my question is about problem number SL3. So I have tried, I am not getting any idea. So kindly give idea to solve SL3, sir.
Exercise SL3. Okay. We have a thermally insulated cylinder closed at both ends. That means our overall system is an isolated system. It seems to be an isolated system. Thermally insulated cylinder closed at both ends, that means Q is 0 and W expansion is 0. Fitted with a leak proof frictionless diathermic piston which divides the cylinder into two parts. Initially, the piston is clamped in the center. Okay, so the piston is in the center and it is diathermic. It is clamped in the center. On one side, you have 1 liter of air at 300 K and 3 bar. So, you have air 1 liter 300 K, 3 bar. On the other side, you have 1 liter of air at 300 K and 1 bar. Okay, this is also air. This is 1 liter. This is 300 K and this is 1 bar. The piston is diathermic, so 300 K on either side is okay, it will maintain that. It needs to be clamped because pressure on one side is 3 bar, pressure on the other side is 1 bar. Okay. So, when the piston is released and reaches equilibrium in pressure and temperature at some new position. So, because of this, if I release the piston, notice what will happen. There is a higher pressure on one side, 3 bar, there is a lower pressure on the other side. So, the piston will start accelerating towards the 1 bar side. There will be some back and forth jerky movement, it is not given to be quasi static. And we have to compute the final pressure and temperature and change in entropy. What irreversible process has taken place? You will notice that there is no hint of any electrical work or any stirrer work. So, we can consider that the total work is 0. So, that means with Q equal to 0, W equal to 0, it is an isolated system. So, the first law will simply tell us delta E is 0. Assuming that this is a stationary system on a table or in a lab, so there will be delta Ek and delta Ep to be 0. So, we can say that first law finally reduces to 0 equals delta U, because we can assume delta Ek, delta Ep also to be negligible or essentially 0. We have to determine the final state. In the final state, remember, assume the final state will be made up of a uniform temperature because the piston is diathermic. So, let T2 be the final temperature. We also know that the final pressure will have to be the same on either side. So, because the piston is frictionless. So, let P2 be the pressure on either side. We also know the final volume. The final volume will be 1 liter on the left hand side plus 1 liter, not 1 liter on the left hand side and 1 liter on the right hand side. The final total volume V2 of, say, this is the A part of the system, this is the B part of the system, V2A plus V2B is going to be 2 liters. Okay. That is, we know, but we do not know what is T2 and we do not know what is P2. We can apply the following relations. The equations which we have is, one equation is this, okay. The second equation is this. Delta U is 0. The third equation is going to be the equation of state for part A. That means P2 VA2 by T2 will be P1A, which is 3 bar, V1A, which is 1 liter, divided by T1. Which is 300 K. The fourth equation would be same thing for the second part. So, P2 VB2 divided by T2 will be pressure of 1 initial state B part, volume of 1 B part, divided by T1. I can write T1 because it is the same thing on either side. And these four equations will give you the four unknowns T2, P2, V2A and V2B. So, you have four equations, four unknown. Solve them. Remember what the four equations are. One is the fixed geometry. So, the volume remains unchanged VA and VB, totally 2 liters. Second equation is first law, third equation is the equation of state applied between the initial and final state of part A, and the second is the equation of state, the fourth one is the equation of state applied to part B between its initial state and final state. And once you know the initial and final states of the two subsystems involved, A and B. You can determine the entropy change of A as well as the entropy change of B, sum it up, and you will get the entropy change of the total isolated system. Over to you.
Thank you. Another is the significance of Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Over to you, sir.
Okay. The significance of the Clausius-Clapeyron equation is the following. If you take the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, tells us how the saturation pressure varies with temperature. This turns out to be, if for example, if you apply it to the liquid vapor equilibrium, this will be HFG divided by VFG. And this comes out by applying in the two phase zone, say on the TS diagram. Let us say you take at some point in the TS diagram, you determine the value of partial of P with respect to T at constant V. And you also determine partial of P with respect to T at constant S. And for this, obtain a relation using the Maxwell's relation. Obtain a relation using the Maxwell's relation. And you will notice that because in the two-phase zone, an isotherm is also an isobar, you will find that both these things are equal, and that is obvious so because in the two-phase zone, pressure is a function only of temperature, so whether you keep the volume constant or the entropy constant does not matter. And from that you will be able to show that dP by dT in the saturation zone turns out to be the way entropy varies with specific volume, either at constant pressure or at constant temperature. And since in the two-phase zone, constant pressure also means constant temperature, and S and V at constant P or T would only be a function of the dryness fraction X, one additional algebraic step will show that this is SFG divided by VFG. This is one way of deriving the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Another way of deriving is in the exercise sheet. For example, after second law, if you go to the property relations part, I think the derivation of the Clausius-Clapeyron equation is PR17, but it can also be derived using the technique provided in PR18. Using a small Carnot cycle between two temperatures T and T minus dT. Also, you will find that various textbooks have various other tricks of using the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Coming to the second part of your question, that how, what is the application of this? Let me again come to the PT diagram of water. This is the triple point, and I said that the solid liquid line bends towards the left, indicating that as you increase pressure, the boiling point reduces, whereas as you increase pressure, the melting point reduces, but as you increase pressure, the boiling point increases. And now here you will notice that if I apply my dP by dT to the saturation, of the solid liquid kind, then this means that I must have S on the right hand side S liquid minus S solid divided by V liquid minus V solid. Now, S liquid minus S solid can be shown to be equal to 1 over T H solid liquid. This is the latent heat of fusion. This is the melting point. And this now turns out to be 1 over rho liquid minus 1 over rho vapor. Now, this is a positive number, this is a positive number, but we know that ice floats on water. That means the density of the solid, sorry, this is liquid and this is solid. So, density of the solid is lower than the density of the liquid, and hence reciprocal of the density of solid will be higher than reciprocal of the density of the liquid. Hence, the denominator will be a negative number since everything else is positive. This turns out to be a negative number. That means if you increase the pressure, the saturation temperature will reduce. Any solid liquid combination where the solid floats on liquid, as in case of water, will have this characteristic that the melting point will decrease as the pressure increases. Whereas, wherever you have a solid liquid combination of a material where the solid sinks in the liquid, you will find that the melting point increases as the pressure increases. Apply this to the liquid vapor equilibrium at this point, and you will notice that because the vapor always floats over the liquid, a bubble always rises. So, the density of the vapor is lower than the density of the liquid, and hence the, as the pressure increases, temperature also increases. This is a typical example where thermodynamics puts a restriction between the relations of properties, but not on the properties themselves. Thermodynamics will never tell us that property of one, this property of this substance at this particular temperature pressure has to have this value. But it will give us some funny relation saying that, for example, this is the relation between latent heat, temperature and the two densities. And that is related to how the saturation pressure varies with saturation temperature, or saturation temperature varies with saturation pressure. That's about it. Over to you.
Thank you very much, sir, for nice explanation. Over and out, sir.
One, 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 two, SUV College, Tirupati, Chittur. Over to you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Coming tomorrow morning.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I have one question regarding the exergy.
Regarding exergy, go ahead.
Yes, sir. What happens to the exergy when a system performs a cyclic process, undergoes a cyclic process?
I couldn't hear your question. Can you repeat it?
Sir, when a system undergoes a cyclic process, what happens to the exergy of that system?
See, if we define the exergy, I suppose we have defined exergy yesterday as the flow exergy as H minus T naught S. So, it is a funny property which depends on the state, also depends on the environment temperature. So, when a system executes a cycle, naturally it comes back to the same enthalpy and same temperature, same entropy, and hence the exergy change of a system after executing a cycle will be zero. Over to you.
One more question, sir. Hello. Sir, in yesterday's examination, there was a question. Water exists in atmospheric condition is given as super saturated steam. How it is? I didn't understand that one.
What you mean is water exists in normally in air, in superheated steam. You need an explanation. Over to Professor Bhandarkar, psychrometry expert.
Okay, see, water, you should realize that this is in vapor form, it's a gaseous form, and at the saturation vapor pressure, the temperature of the water is above the saturation temperature for that vapor pressure, and hence it's a superheated form of the substance. So that is why it is in a superheated form. In fact, you can say it is no different from any of the gases that is existing, like nitrogen and oxygen. All of them are existing in superheated form. Thank you.
Sir, one more question, sir. Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, why that liquid vapor saturation line is ending at critical point? After that, will there be any change in that line in two different ways?
The question is, why is the liquid vapor saturation line ending at the critical point? Okay. Thermodynamics does not have any answer to this, but all I can say is that the structure of the three phases is such that solid has a distinct phase, standard solid has some crystalline, locally crystalline structure. The gases on the other hand have a absolutely random unstructured behavior leading to kinetic theory and all that. Liquids are somewhat in between, but being fluids they are more nearer to gases than to solids, and particularly as you go to higher and higher temperatures, automatically means higher and higher pressures, but for a particular fluid, as you go to higher and higher temperatures, the intermolecular forces in the liquids reduce, whereas the kinetic behavior, kinetic energy of liquid particles increases. And at certain stages, the kinetic energy becomes comparable and equal to that of a vapor, whereas the intermolecular forces become negligibly small. And when that happens, that balancing point is known as the critical point. Means at critical point, this balance takes place, removing the distinction between a liquid and a vapor. So, if you want more details, you will have to look up research papers and papers on the statistical thermodynamics and kinetic theory of liquids. Over to you.
Sir, one more question, sir. Hello, sir.
Go ahead.
Sir, in some of the books I have seen that the loop in a PV diagram as available work and whatever that is below is given as unavailable work.
No, that's not really true. Your question is, a loop in a PV diagram for a cycle. We have seen in the morning or yesterday, I think, I showed it as, what is this is the net work output. Maybe I should go back to that particular slide. Yes, this figure. Okay. Now notice, we have a loop in the PV diagram, and what is shown by horizontal red lines, this is the net output. And the area under the curve, which is doubly hashed like this, is actually the work done by processes which are essentially the compression type of processes to complete the loop. Nothing about unavailable work. Don't bring in availability and unavailability in such simple things. It will only confuse our availability analysis further. This is just work done in expansion part of the cycle and work done in the compression part of the cycle. The difference would be the net work delivered to the outside world.
Thank you, sir.
Over and out.